This week, I'm going to show you how I choose a location for astrophotography. Whenever I'm scouting a location, I always think about what it might be like at night, whether there are big sources of light nearby, or if it's a good dark sky location. The main things that affect how many stars you will get in your shots are the moon and where it is in its cycle, man-made light sources like cities or big industrial areas, and the air quality, including pollution and dust particles. First of all, it needs to be a clear night so you can see the stars. There are lots of apps for this, but the ones I use are the BBC Weather app, AccuWeather, and the new one I've recently discovered is Clear Outside, which shows cloud cover percentage. It also has so much other information, from fog and rain forecasts to sunrise and setting times. It also includes the Bortle class scale, which I'll go into in a minute. Next, we need to plan around the moon cycles. For this, it's good to get an app like Photopills or the Photographer's Ephemeris. This will tell you when there will be a new moon or full moon, where it'll be in the sky, as well as lots of other resources to help you. They are paid apps, but they're well worth the investment. You basically need to plan to go out around a new moon, maybe a few days before or a few days after. This will give you very little moonlight and a lot more stars. With man-made light sources, you just need to get as far away from them as possible. I use a website called Light Pollution Map to work out where the best places are to go for astrophotography shots. From this, you can see the color coding. The whites and reds are cities and big industrial areas. You want to look for the areas of blue or black that are away from any red and white areas. Saying this, I've got some good shots in the yellow and one or two in the red areas from Sandbanks Beach on the south coast of the UK. On the map, you can see it's in a red area. However, I was looking out to sea towards a really dark area with no light pollution, and that's why it still worked. These colours basically represent differing levels of visibility. If you click anywhere on the map, you'll get a whole load of data appearing. The only thing I look at is the Bortle figure. The Bortle scale is a 9-level numeric scale that measures the night sky's brightness of a particular location. John E. Bortle created the scale and published it in the February 2001 edition of Sky and Telescope magazine. This basically means that the lower the class number, the more stars you'll get in the sky. So class 1 is excellent and you'll have a sky filled with stars. Class 9, you'll hardly see any. If you only have a short time to travel, find the best spot near you with this map, then go and explore. You obviously need to wait for a clear night, but sometimes the odd cloud in the shot can add to it. Then do some research on air quality. The hazier it is, the less stars you'll be able to see. Here in the United Arab Emirates, we sometimes get hazy skies, and this does bleach out the stars. I just keep an eye on the air quality. When it's good, I head out into the desert, away from any light sources. In contrast to this, when New Zealand has clear skies and a new moon, you can see so many stars as there is very little dust or haze in the air. Although, they have bigger and more frequent storms, so every area has its pros and cons. Just do a little research in the area that you're at, and you'll be able to work out when's best to go out. I tend to look for places that are far from cities. If I'm shooting the Milky Way, I'll make sure there are no cities in the direction of the Milky Way to get as little light pollution in the shot as possible. If you have a light source on the horizon, this can really mess up the shot. If there are dust particles in the air or if it's hazy, these can then amplify that light. Last weekend we went into the desert. I planned it properly and I looked on this light pollution map to see where the best places were. We've got a new moon and the air quality is really good, so it's a perfect time to go out and shoot the stars. These are the shots that I got from this shoot. I had to make sure there were no really big cities to the south and southwest where the Milky Way was in the sky. As long as you do this, you should get some really good results. Another thing to think about is the foreground element. You need something on the ground in the shot to almost anchor the Milky Way to the ground, or to have a landscape that complements the starry skies. Sometimes I'll use my car, or maybe a road, or in this case, in the Leeward Desert, a dunescape with a leading line to the bottom of the Milky Way. If there are trees, you can frame the sky with those trees. And if you want, you can even do a self-portrait. As they say, the sky's the limit. And that's about it. With a good app like Photopills, the light pollution map, and Google Maps, you can plan a really good location for your astrophotography shots. All you have to do then is wait for clear skies around the new moon. If there's anything that you do differently to plan your astrophotography shots, let me know in the comments below. It'll be great to hear how you do it. As always, if you like what you see, give me a thumbs up. If you didn't, give me a thumbs down. And for weekly tutorials, hints and tips in photography and videography, subscribe and turn on notifications. I'll see you in the next one.